kind of feels like with your films, you're sort of moving very slowly towards a certain maturity. You've had sort of guys on their own, guys looking for these women, guys trying to find love. Now you've got married guys, but at the same time, you've kind of reset it so that they can find women. Is that something you find yourself moving towards in your careers as you get older and you sort of have families, that sort of stuff?
Wow, that's kind of observant. I didn't realize that. You know, it's not a conscious effort. It's interesting. Like, we don't have like a long-term plan, but sometimes things happen just because of the very reasons you said that we don't even understand why. But when we read this script, which came from Pete Jones, he wrote the first draft, we did relate to it. We found it very funny. We loved the concept, and I guess it's because that's where we are in our lives. But
yeah, I guess that's right. Yeah, we... it's easier for us to make a comedy about something that we know about, and we're both married, and so, you know, this is a comedy about marriage, so it was natural for us.
And at the same time, you're also fairly well respected for writing women as decent characters, as opposed to being, I mean, the women in this film could have been shrews, they could have been saints, but you've kind of found the middle ground. You've found, you know, they're not perfect, they get their own hall pass, they're tempted,
yeah,
you know, and they're sick of their boys. So was that something that you consciously put effort into?
To be perfectly honest, the first draft that we wrote of this with Pete Jones and Kevin Barnett, I showed to my wife and she threw it down. She said, I hate these people. I hate everybody in it.
Right.
I was like, what? She said, I can't stand them. I said, why? She said, because in that draft, you know, the guys had the hall pass and the women sat at home biting their fingernails and they're like, I wonder what they're doing now. What do you think they're doing now? You think they're getting laid? You know, blah, blah, blah. And my wife said, if you got a hall pass, I have a hall pass. Yeah. And you'll be the one biting your fingernails, not me. and then when we rewrote it like that, we were fair to the women. And to be perfectly fair to the women, putting them out there, well, they can make mistakes too, or make decisions that they might regret. Mm. And they should be punished for their mistakes and learn from their mistakes. And you know, it's not just guys who make mistakes.
You've talked previously about Stephen Merchant, how great he is. I think if anything, the film could do with almost more Steve Merchant.
Yeah.
Is there more Steve Merchant lurking out there in DVD land that you'll be able to sort of put on deleted scenes?
You know, we realize that. We cast Stephen Merchant in a, I guess you'd just say a lesser role. He's one of their buddies, and he just didn't have that much time in the movie. But when we got toward the end of the movie, we thought, geez, I wish we had more for Stephen Merchant, you know, and we ended up filming a little thing for the end credits for Stephen. But we've come to the realization that we're going to look for a project for him.
Yeah, that was an afterthought, that end credit sequence, just because we're like, we haven't had Stephen in a half hour. We've got to get him in here.
I need more Stephen.
Yeah.
So he's someone that you're definitely looking forward to working with. He could crop up in Three Stooges, I think you said.
Yeah, we're going to do the Three Stooges next. And I was saying, I don't know that he'll be one of the Three Stooges, I'd love to get him in there.
I don't think he's available, to be honest. We've already even gone down that road. He's doing something.
I'm not taking no for an answer.
Ricky Gervais, but he's a guy that, you know, I think he's one of the funniest guys on the planet, and we would love to be in business with him again and again and again. Love that guy. So funny, and a great guy to hang with.